Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the webinar Why Science, organized by Department of Chemistry in association with University Computer Center, Mohanlal Sukharia University, Udaipur. I am Dr. Siddharth Sharma, an assistant professor at Mohanlal Sukharia University and moderator for this webinar. During this webinar, you can ask questions to the speaker, and some of the questions will be delivered to him by me as a moderator. Before going into the detail, I just want to introduce that why science was chosen as a topic with an intention to inspire the young generation towards science by connecting university and schools. This is an initiative taken by our head of the department, Dr. Jyoti Chaudhary, under the leadership of Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor America Singh. We as a Department of Chemistry believe this is a very ethical partnership where a high school student can be prepared for the bigger challenges, such as basic science as a career option, or even more. And to do this important task, it was indeed important to find a person of a caliber who himself is an emblem of science in India. And I mean to say that kind of a person who can justify this simple, at the same time, deep-rooted topic. In this case, I am honored and privileged to introduce today's speaker. Indeed, I must say this is even personally a wonderful day for me as well to introduce Professor Gautam R. Desiraju. Professor Desiraju is a former professor at India's elite institute, Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. Professor Desiraju was born on 21st of August 1952 in Madras. He obtained his BSc from St. Xavier's College, Mumbai, and a PhD in 1976 from University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, United States of America. Then later, he joined as a lecturer in the University of Hyderabad, and then he moved to the Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. Professor Desiraju is basically a structural chemist and contributed substantially to research field of crystal engineering. His major research contributions is on supramolecular synthon, weak hydrogen bonding, and he is one of the most highly cited Indian scientists with more than 483 publications and a total citation of 57,000. This looks kind of an imaginary number from a normal point of view, but this is true with Professor Desiraju. He has received several prestigious awards like Alexander von Humboldt Award by Germany, ISA Medal for Science, University of Bologna, Italy. He also served as a president of International Union of Crystallography. And beside this, he has been on the advisory board of world's one of the top journals in science, especially in chemistry, such as Engavante Chemi and American Chemical Society, Journal of American Chemical Society, that is JACS. So before I invite Professor Desiraju, I would like all the YouTube viewers to subscribe our channel, that is the Internet Center MLSU. And without going into the much detail, I would like to humbly request Professor Desiraju to deliver his talk on why science. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Siddharth. And do you think I can do the share screen now? Yes?
Yes, sir, you can share the screen.
Do you see the full screen, everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let us start in this case. I'd like to thank Dr. Sharma, the head of the department, the vice chancellor of Sukadia University in Udaipur, for having invited me. And I hope everybody can hear it loudly and nice.
Yes.
No problem. And I was keen on speaking here today because Dr. Sharma told me that there would be a large number of young people, maybe in plus two, and people who are in coaching classes trying to write exams to get into engineering and other courses, also maybe some BSc students, but basically young people. And I know that this COVID time is very anxious. You people don't even know if a joint entrance exam is going to be postponed or not. So I know there's a lot of tension. So I'm just going to ask you to forget about all these things for 1 hour. And I want to talk to you about why anybody should do science, or why do we even need science. And I'm not going to talk usual sorts of things that, you know, science is great, science is good for the country. If you do science, then we will all be nice. So we will leave that to the professional politicians. Why do we need, not that why you have to study science or do, why do you need science at all? What does science teach you? What do scientists teach you? And why is it different from other activities? Even in academics or even in technical education, there are so many things. What is special about science? So to do this, I mean, there have been so many great scientists. Even if you take last 400 or 500 years, I mean, so many scientists we've seen in the last 120 years when we've had Nobel Prizes. About 500 people have got a Nobel Prize in some science subject or the other. So there are very many excellent scientists who have been going around. So out of this huge number, I wanted to select just a small number. And I originally have selected a group of about 30 scientists. And even 30, I felt, was a bit too many. So for today's lecture, I narrowed it down to about 10 scientists over the last 300-400 years whom I'd like to talk about. And not really to say that, oh, these people did very great science or something like that, because in each of these 10 cases, there's something extra, something special, something unusual. And some of these scientists, actually almost all these 10, faced some sort of big difficulty somewhere or the other in their careers and lives. So how did science, the methods of science, how did science influence their lives? Did science help them to overcome these difficulties? And what did they have to give to science in exchange? So each one of these 10 people is somewhat, in my mind, very special. Somebody else could pick some other scientists. I mean, that is the nature of science. So the beauty is in the eye of the beholder. So it really depends from person to person. But anyway, without wasting much time, we'll go to the first of my choices. And that is Galileo. Now, all of us know all the important details of his life, but what I'd like to tell you is some of the methods that he employed and some of the difficulties that he got into. I mean, there was something in those days which was called perspicillium, which was obtained by taking two convex lenses. And when you looked at an object through these two convex lenses, the object looked magnified. Now, Galileo, this happened in Netherlands. So Galileo heard of this. Galileo, he's in, of course, in a small place in Italy called Pavia, which is outside Venice. And so he saw this result and then he got an idea. And he took these lenses and he kind of placed them in a better way. And that old perspicillium from Netherlands was giving a magnification of threefold. He managed to get tenfold magnification. And also in that perspicillium, the image, that expanded image you saw, was upside down, which you can understand with convex lenses. And he managed to give an expanded image, which is right side up. Now, having done this, he said that, firstly, I'm going to call it a different name. He said this perspicillium looks like some old fashioned name. So he said he gave it a new name, and that new name was telescope. So you see, first thing that Galileo knew is he knew about marketing. You people will all go, you will join IIT, IIM, they will teach you all so many things. But firstly, to be a good scientist, you have to be good in marketing. So he changed the name. So by changing the name, the discovery sort of was attributed to him and not to that person in Netherlands. You see how clever he is, cunning. Change the name. And then the next thing he did was he went and saw the Duke of Venice. Now here you can see Venice. This is a picture of the famous city of Venice, which is lying in half in the water, you know. Instead of streets, they have canals over there. And this is the palace of the Duke over there. And he was a very powerful fellow. And Venice was very powerful place in those days because it is situated right here, you know. You see the arrow in the second picture where I'm pointing. Wait, let's see, let's get it. Ah, it's right there. Right there is the arrow. Venice is over there and it's on the sea. And you see, this is whole of Europe. And so all the nice things from Asia, which are coming by sea, would come here, land in Venice, and then they will go all over Europe. So Venice therefore became a very, very rich place. And they had one problem. Look at all these red things over here. This is where all the Turkish people, Turks, were all there. Turkey, you know, always dangerous country, very dangerous. So even in those days, they were dangerous. So they would always come and try to attack and do so many things. So Galileo went and told the Duke, he said, look, I've got this new thing called telescope. If you see in the sea outside Venice with this telescope sitting over here, you can see when the ships of the Turkish people are coming, and you can see them from a distance. You cannot see them with the eye, and you can see it with this telescope. So this picture down here looks like his original telescope, how it used to look. And so Duke, of course, was very happy because he said, oh, if I get to see this enemy very quickly, then I can start firing at them before they even know that I have seen them. And obviously, this has got great military strategy. So second thing is that first Galileo did marketing. Secondly, he said, okay, he went and sold his idea to a politician. So that way he got money. The Duke also made him professor for life. So you see, he got a lot of bonus by just doing this thing and knowing how to sell his science. You know, selling the science is also very important, not just doing good science. Then after doing all these nice things, he did what he really wanted to do. He started looking at the heavens. So you can see this Galileo is looking at the microscope and he's looking at the heaven. He's not looking anymore at the ships and the harbor and all that. So that finished. That part is over. Now he's looking at heavens, and then he started seeing moon. And then he, just like the moon goes around the earth, he could see moons going around the planet Jupiter. So he's the first person who saw moons of Jupiter. And then he suddenly found there are so many stars in the sky, which you cannot see normally with the naked eye. This telescope was just bringing everything closer, and you could see everything so clearly. And he was getting fantastic ideas, and he said, there's a whole bunch out there in the sky we don't know about. And so it was just one result led to the other. Now at this stage, the big crisis in his life came. You see, he attracted the attention of the church. His church in Rome, this church was always connected with politics. Rome is here, you know, somewhere here it is. Venice is over there, so not very far. And the Roman church, Catholic church, was very, very powerful in those days. So it was not just a religious organization, but a lot of political power. So these fellows are always interested to play some politics with Venice. So they said, what is this Galileo doing? He's saying that there are so many stars in the sky and all. So he said, in the Bible, it's written that the stars have been put in the sky by God to illuminate the earth for man's benefit. So stars are there in the sky. God put the stars there so that they can illuminate the earth. So then they said, what he is saying is against the Bible, because why would there be a star which we cannot see? You know, because Galileo said that there is a star that you cannot see, but you can see through my telescope. So they said, no, this is going against the will of God. They found some small excuse to catch him. And even in those days, apparently, this is all these church people in this last picture here. They're all sitting over here. And even in this group, there was some division. People said that you should not literally take what is written in the Bible as correctly. We have to go on interpreting and all that. And other people said, no. What is written in the Bible is exactly correct and so on. So there was some politics between these groups. And finally, they called Galileo. And here is Galileo sitting here. And they called him for a trial. They called him for a trial and they said, no, you are blaspheming, you are going against the word of God, so we are going to give you a punishment. These are all the judges sitting over there in front of him, and this is all the church people in Rome. So at this point of time, Galileo was actually quite old, and they also threatened him. They took him to the jail, they showed him the jail, and then they showed him all the instruments of torture. They said, we are going to torture you. We will torture you before we kill you, unless you say that everything that you did is wrong. So and so on and so forth. So they go on harassing him, threatening him. So finally he wrote a piece of paper that everything that I did was wrong and the church is correct. There are no stars. You know, God put the stars, and whatever they wanted him to write, he wrote. So created one crisis in his mind. Apparently, the story says that he signed all this. But apparently, when he signed, he said silently, but not so silently. Some people could hear it, that he said, no, but they are actually there. The stars are there. So it tells you that sometimes when you do good science, and see, the work of Galileo led to the work of Newton, and Galileo actually started the subject called mechanics, and he developed the connection between mathematics and physics. So the work of Galileo lives forever. What the church was saying about stars and sky and God and all that, that has not lasted, you know. But what Galileo said has lasted. So question is that sometimes when you do science, you go on the wrong side of people in the church or people in political power or something like that. Then question is, scientist, should he do the work because he knows that work is correct? Or should he listen to these religious people and say, no, I listen to you because you can kill me, you have the power to kill me? So Galileo, actually, they say he was quite old by then, so he probably weakened. And so it's sort of, I'm leaving the question open. And you young men and women who are listening to this talk, you can sort of decide for yourself whether Galileo should have, you know, confessed like that in front of the church, or whether he should have allowed himself to be killed. And so this brings me to the next person. So this is Galileo was number one. The number two, which I put, is Lavoisier. Now, Lavoisier I have put in here because he faced a similar problem. And if Galileo really developed modern physics, Lavoisier developed modern chemistry. Now, here is Lavoisier himself. The interesting life. He was born in a moderately middle class family, you know, not very rich and so on. And here I put a picture of him with his wife, and I've done it for a certain reason. Because Madame Lavoisier was a very, very big influence in his life. She came from a very rich family. So here is a young man from a middle-class family who married a woman from a much richer family. She is very influential, even in the court and all that. And the family was also very, very wealthy. So suddenly, through the marriage, Lavoisier started seeing a social circle which he could not dream about in the beginning. And it really accounted for also partly his rise. And she also happened to be a chemist. You know, she was a very good chemist herself, which was really extraordinary in those days. Recently, last year or so, I saw a survey, somebody in a poll, who are the most famous, 10 most famous woman chemists ever. And Madame Lavoisier was one of that, one of those 10. So she was actually not a small shot science-wise. She also knew English, which he did not know. So she will translate all his papers, and then she will read the English papers and translate them to Lavoisier. So she did a lot of things, and many people say that she was the real inspiration behind his work. Now, very quickly, I want to tell you what his work was. And his work is so important that today, you know, after 250 years, I'll say that I'm a chemistry person myself. But I'd say that probably he was the greatest chemist who ever lived. And I say that with a good reason, because he is the person who really told us what this great element oxygen is. Till then, nobody really had a good idea about what oxygen is. And Lavoisier, like many other people, was studying the phenomenon of burning. Now, in those days, with the time of Lavoisier, the theory of burning was something like this. They said that all the things that burn have a magic substance in them called phlogiston. Phlogiston was like a kind of fire or something like that inside the substance. So a piece of wood, for example, like over here, a wood or a lead or some metal or something like that, it has got a lot of phlogiston. So that when you burn it, the phlogiston comes out, and what is left is a small amount of ash. So if you take a big piece of wood and burn it, then the phlogiston comes out and the ash is left, which is very small quantity. So phlogiston goes into the air. Then they also knew about rusting. You know, you take an iron nail, after some time it will start rusting. And then usually you find that the weight of the rusted nail is more than the weight of the original iron nail. Now for this, the phlogiston people said, okay, look, the phlogiston is there, but it comes out. And it comes out very slowly. Yeah, it comes out very slowly. And then they said, something which looks very crazy today, and it was even crazy in those days. They said there are two types of phlogiston. One which comes out fast, like when you burn a piece of wood, and one which comes out slowly when the iron rusts. So the fast phlogiston which comes out quickly has got a weight, and the phlogiston that comes out slowly has got negative weight. So because this has got negative weight, that is why the iron, rusted iron nail is heavier. Now, see, today we will laugh when we listen to this theory. But please remember, phlogiston theory went on for 100 years. And many, many important chemistry people believed in this phlogiston theory. And there was actually no proof of phlogiston. Nobody had seen it. It was just a theory. And this is, you know, this, I am giving this example as an example of how sometimes, you know, you have a theory without doing an experiment. When they say this kind of lower kind of phlogiston has a weight and the higher kind of phlogiston has no weight. I mean, nobody has done an experiment to say what is the meaning of a substance with no weight or negative weight. Now, the greatness of Lavoisier was that he introduced the concept of weighing things into chemistry. Weighing, just weighing. You know, so he said, when he heard this whole thing about a negative weight and all, he said, this is nonsense. this is there can be nothing like a negative weight. Things have to have a weight or they are not there also. So then, of course, his very famous experiments, which he did when he took this red oxide of mercury. And this red oxide of mercury is a very special substance because when you heat it, it loses oxygen. And to give mercury metal over here, and you can take the mercury metal and then you can put the oxygen back and then you get red mercury oxide. So that means it's a sort of a reversible reaction. So if you heat mercury oxide, you will get mercury. If you heat mercury in the presence of oxygen, you will get mercury oxide. Of course, in those days, they didn't know there is something called oxygen. Now, that is Lavoisier's great contribution, because there were also some other very important people in those days. One fellow was called Scheele in Sweden. He actually found oxygen, but he couldn't identify it. Then there was a man called Joseph Priestley in England who again found oxygen. And you see how cunningly they explained this oxygen using the phlogiston theory. You know, this is again phlogiston theory. They said, they called oxygen actually, they identified what is oxygen. They called it dephlogisticated air. So they said there is some kind of air that doesn't contain phlogiston, and that is oxygen. So since that air doesn't contain oxygen, phlogiston likes to come very easily into that air. So instead of using a simpler theory that oxygen is a substance that has weight, and when you oxygen reacts with something that is called burning, instead of saying that, they put the whole thing like ulta pulta. So phlogiston became like a kind of minus oxygen. And Lavoisier, who was very good at weighing things, he showed this whole thing of the earlier theory, 100-year theory of phlogiston, all wrong. And then he said there is something called oxygen. This is what it is. It is 1/5 that of air. And then that, of course, started the whole revolution in chemistry. He wrote a very famous book called Elements of Chemistry, and which became immediately popular. And of course, he became very, very famous because of it. Now, there is a sideshow in this life of Lavoisier. I mean, so far, I can say he's a very great chemist. Now, why did I include him in this group of 10 people? You see, when he was in his early years, I told you his wife is from a very rich family. He actually did science as a hobby. His main job was to go into a company which was responsible for collecting taxes for the king. And this company was very cruel. It will take money and all that from very poor people. And it became a very hated company. And so because of all these things, the French Revolution happened when they threw out the king and all that. So he was part of a politically very unpopular group. Once again, you see this politics is coming. And then again, you see the way this science came back to haunt him. Here, there is a picture. I put here a picture of a man called Marat. Now, this Marat was also a scientist, but he came from a very humble family. And he wrote a paper and theory about this phlogiston and all that, which was like all the other phlogiston papers. It was all completely wrong. And by that time, Lavoisier was a very prominent academician in France and all that. And so he looked at that paper and he said, this whole thing is rubbish, and he threw it out. Now, this Marat never forgot that what Lavoisier did, although he was wrong scientifically and Lavoisier was correct, he never forgot that one. And then later on, when the French Revolution happened, this Marat happened to be one of the main people who did that French Revolution. So he became very, very powerful politically. He was not very good as a scientist, but he became very powerful politically. And immediately he said he was beginning to look at Lavoisier. And so they caught him and they put one very quick trial, fake trial. And then they said, in those days, you see this last picture here is guillotine, where they will keep the people here and then tap, the blade will fall and then the head will be cut off. So they said this Lavoisier is all bogus. And in fact, Marat made a statement, you know, it was called Republic, because before, when the king was there, it was monarchy. So when the king was thrown out, he became a republic. He said, "Republic has no need for scientists." So you see, scientists can become so unpopular with political people. There's no need for scientists. So they did one, you know, mock trial actually. It was over very quickly. They said, right, he has to put in the guillotine and chop his head off. And so at the age of 50, this very famous chemist, who is the greatest chemist in the world, at the age of 50, he lost his head in the guillotine. So I'm giving this second example. Unlike Galileo, he paid with his life. But see, today, after 250 years, who knows about Marat? Because I told you today, you know about him. But whole world knows about Lavoisier even today. So what does it matter if you die at 50? What does it matter if you lose your head? If what you said is eternally correct, then I think that is the only thing that matters. And Lavoisier said something that is eternally correct because he believed in the scientifically correct practice of weighing things. That's all. Simple. Just how to weigh something correctly, he knew. And so the rest of it followed. So he was willing to take the results of his actions because I don't think he felt any doubt. He, unlike Galileo, he did not say that all the things which I did are wrong or something like that. He never said anything like that. So that is the story of Lavoisier. So we'll leave that and we'll go to the third person. And this is Kekule. I don't want to spend too much time on him. Most of you learn even in plus two level that he is the person who gave the cyclic structure of benzene. And yes, he is very well known for that. And the most famous thing about Kekule is that he said, look at this here, let us learn to dream, then we may perhaps find the truth. So he said that scientists also are allowed to dream, because the structure of benzene, as you know, was a great problem. The molecular formula is C6H6, whereas the formula of the corresponding saturated hydrocarbon hexane is C6H14. So that means benzene has got far less number of hydrogens compared to hexane. And usually in those days, even because of Kekule's earlier work, you can get less number of hydrogens by putting double bonds. So if you put from hexane C6H14, if you go to hexene, you'll get C6H12. And if you take hexadiene, you'll get, you know, C6H8 and things like that. So you will, by the time you get, you can do get C6H6 also with double bonds, triple bonds and all that. But there's a big problem in all those open chain compounds, that these compounds will all decolorize bromine water, whereas benzene was not decolorizing bromine water. So it never showed the typical properties of unsaturated compounds like hexene and hexadiene and all that. So there's a problem. It was not behaving. The other thing is that hexane, for example, burns with a blue flame, just like your butane in LPG. It burns with a blue flame, no? But benzene burns with what is called a sooty flame, yellow color flame, and then gives a lot of soot. So characteristic of these what are called aromatic compounds. So the whole behavior of benzene is different from hexane, hexene and all that. And so Kekule, who was a master of valency and all by then, he was just struggling all the time. And one day apparently he was so tired that he was just sleeping off and doesn't know what is happening. And as he is sleeping, it was the winter time and there was a big fire in the fireplace. And then he saw these the fiery things, and suddenly fire became a sort of a loop going on itself. And then he is supposed to have dreamt that he saw a snake which is swallowing its own tail. So then immediately he got the answer. He said, "Arey, this benzene is not at all like hexane and hexene. Benzene has got a what is called cyclic structure. The carbon atoms are in a ring. And because of this ring, And because these double bonds can alternate, this is from Kekulé's original paper, the double bond is sometimes here, sometimes here, sometimes here, sometimes here. So because of that, benzene does not decolorize bromine water. So he got that also. So cut in one flash, he got the whole structure of benzene through the dream. And so this means that the dreaming is not bad, provided you know enough of your subject. Sometimes, you know, say scientist dreams swirling answer to problematic question. Sometimes when nothing else works, dreams work. So this is Kekulé. So we leave him for now. But this also tells you that scientists are human beings, you know. They struggle with their research problem. And they don't know always what is the best way of solving the problem. Now let us go to the next person. It's almost like opposite of dreams. This is of course the famous Mendeleev. And we all know that Mendeleev gave us what is called the periodic table of elements. And here it is. Now, the background of Mendeleev's research is really that by about 1860, the chemistry people had a fairly good idea of atomic weights. So they were able to, these atomic weights gave some kind of idea, quantitative idea, because Lavoisier had told them how to weigh things. So they weighed everything. And they found, for example, that just to take a simple example, which all of you know, NaOH plus HCl equals NaCl plus H2O. So they said that if you take 58.5 for 40 grams of NaOH, and if you put 36.5 grams exactly of HCl, you will get exactly 58.5 grams of sodium chloride. So like that, they knew so many things. And they said for 40 grams of NaOH, instead of taking 36.5 grams of hydrochloric acid, if you take 81 grams of hydrobromic acid, it will give you the same result. You will get sodium bromide exactly. And water, 18 grams of water. So people had a very good idea of atomic weights. Once they had the idea of atomic weights, they started assigning atomic weights to elements. And they also knew from their qualitative knowledge of these elements, there were some resemblances between elements. For example, chlorine, bromine, iodine had some similarities. Lithium, sodium, potassium had some similarities. So they tried to group elements in groups of three. Because see, in science, you are not, we are never very happy to just get data and sit on the data. Data can be very good. But just sitting on the data, no scientist is happy, very curious. He or she wants to find out what is the meaning of that data, why the data is like that. Then so they said, okay, these elements are all there in groups of three. Then some other people said that no, it's not groups of three. But there are groups of seven. So if you take lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, if you go through seven, in those days they didn't know neon. So then they said the eighth one is like the first, the ninth one is like the second, the tenth one is like the third. So they said there is some relationship in seven. Some people said there's a relationship in three. And the problem with all these ideas was they were very, very qualitative. No idea as to what is the bigger picture. Some small things are coming in the pattern, but the big picture is not coming out. And then some people actually started saying, what are these atomic weights? These atomic weights, firstly, proper atomic weights were given, as I said, in 1860 by an Italian chemist called Cannizzaro. So they said, okay, what are these atomic weights? Shall we try to see if they make any sense? And so then they started, people already started arranging the elements in increasing order of atomic weight. But even here, you know, you can start with hydrogen. You can go up to lithium, fluorine, you end up like this, you could see some relationship. Then around here, the whole thing breaks down. Because they knew vanadium, chromium and all, they knew all those elements, and then you put them all there and then it doesn't make any sense. And then suddenly you get some known elements like selenium, bromine. So you can't arrange them in seven and all anymore. That doesn't work. So they started saying, what is going on? And Mendeleev also was a very famous chemist of that time. And so he tried to put his mind to it. And of course, we all know he came up with this periodic table. But, and it is said that he got to this periodic table by playing a game of patience with playing cards. But that may be just a story. But the reason he got the correct answer of this periodic table is because for him, the properties that were similar are more important than the atomic weights. He used atomic weights all right to increase or align all these elements. But for example, his two most famous results, which make him really, really great, is if you look at these two elements, this tellurium and iodine, you please take a look here, right down here. Now, actually, if you look at tellurium and iodine, the atomic weight of tellurium is 128, whereas the atomic weight of iodine is only 127. So the element which has got a lower atomic weight is put higher, and that which has the higher atomic weight is put lower. So Mendeleev knew that this tellurium and iodine, he was putting in the wrong order, but he said, I'm going to put it in the wrong order. Because he said, there is something here that I don't understand. He said, bromine is too similar to iodine and selenium is too close to tellurium. So if I put actually taking only strictly atomic weights, then I'll have to put iodine here and tellurium here. And he said, that doesn't make any sense to me. So he put properties before the atomic weight. So he said, most scientists would not do something like this. Because they, by the way, they could get atomic weights very accurately. I know you'll ask me that, would you think that he got the atomic weight of tellurium and iodine wrong? No, they were getting atomic weights correctly. So the numbers are correct. Mendeleev put them in the wrong order. And today we know that, of course, he couldn't have known in those days because they didn't know the structure of the atom. But today we know that when you put it in the order of atomic number and not atomic weight, then this tellurium before iodine makes sense. It's correct actually with atomic number. So even without knowing the full theory, he put the idea of this table higher than just the atomic weights that were known to him. That was his first great contribution. His second contribution, please look at this aluminium and gallium here. In those days, when Mendeleev did this, around 1869, he did this periodic table. Gallium was not known. It was not a known element. So we used to have in those days copper and then zinc. Actually, you didn't know germanium also. We had arsenic. So he said, copper is all right. He put this below potassium. He put zinc below calcium. And then he came here and then he said, arsenic is like phosphorus. So he decided to put arsenic below phosphorus and then selenium sulfur. This was of course very well known. So there were actually two gaps over here for gallium and germanium. So there was nothing that looks like aluminium and there's nothing that looks like silicon. He just left empty places. See how many scientists will do this? You know, he said something very bold. He said, no, an element will be discovered which looks like aluminium. And I'm going to call that, he was a great fan of Sanskrit. So he said, I'm going to call it Eka aluminium. And he said, something is going to be found in the future that looks like silicon. So I'm going to call it Eka silicon. So when gallium and germanium were actually found, they were found to be exactly like aluminium and silicon. And in fact, there's a famous joke about aluminium and gallium. There was a French chemist who actually discovered gallium And Mendeleev, you see, had put all the properties, he had predicted all the properties of gallium based on aluminium. And the French chemist said, no, no, the density which you have got for gallium is not what the density which I got when I made gallium. So then Mendeleev is supposed to have told him, he said, you have done your experiment wrong. He says, purify your sample. He said, if you purify your sample, you will get the correct atomic weight. So sure is he of his theory that he said, your experiment is wrong. Usually most scientists will go for an experiment and then they'll say the experiment is correct and they'll try to fit a theory around the experiment. He said, no, my theory is correct, your experiment is wrong. That means he is so sure about his theory that he could actually tell him, you go and do your experiment again. And then he went, this French chemist went and did the experiment again. And he did find that he was wrong and Mendeleev was correct. That density was what Mendeleev had predicted. And here is, of course, a picture of Mendeleev with his family. So he came from a pretty affluent family, as you can see from the dress and other things. They could even afford to get photographed and all in those days. So he didn't come from a poor background. He was a very famous chemistry professor already when he did this periodic table. And look at this quotation in the bottom right-hand corner. The edifice of science not only requires material, but also a plan. Without material, the plan alone is but a castle in the air, a mere possibility. That is just guesswork or dreaming. While the material without a plan is but useless matter. You see, he is giving both the pitfalls. And many, many scientists even today are guilty of these errors. Plan without material, material without plan. Both are bad. You need a plan and you need the material to back it up. You know, otherwise, if you have, for example, no material, no plan, it becomes like some fake news in social media. So science is different from social media. And Mendeleev was the one who taught us all these things. And he taught it to us in a very, very, very nice way. And you know, the greatness of Mendeleev, you can see, is that today it is called periodic law. You know, this word law is used very rarely in chemistry. If it is used, it is used in physical chemistry. You know, Henry's law, Raoult's law, Boyle's law. It is used mostly in physical chemistry, which is going towards physics. Physics is full of laws because it is based on numbers. Chemistry is not based on numbers. And it is very difficult to have a law. At the maximum in chemistry, we have rules. And the beauty in chemistry is you can have a rule and you will also have an exception to the rule. And in organic chemistry especially, the exceptions are more than the rule actually. So that is what makes organic chemistry very beautiful. And those people who like exceptions more than rules like to go for organic chemistry. It is a very, very, very deeply psychological thing. So if you are of that mentality where you like the exception, then go take organic. It's very, very rare in chemistry, in general chemistry, in organic chemistry, to have a law. So we call it today periodic law. So that means a law means, excuse me, in science, a law means there are no exceptions. These are not like, you know, laws in the Constitution, because those laws are all man-made. So Supreme Court can go and make it into some other law. That doesn't. But the scientific laws are not made by man. They are made from somewhere else. And so to get that word law in a chemistry context is very, very rare. Such is the greatness of Mendeleev. Now let's move on. Now the next person I want to talk about is a tragic hero, Richard Willstetter. And the thing about Willstetter is he is most famous. He got a Nobel Prize in 1920, but he is most famous for this synthesis of this compound alkaloid called tropene. Now, if you take this tropene, this is found in this plant, deadly nightshade, from the flower of this plant. And if you look at this thing, tropene, Willstetter in 1906 made this compound. He was a famous professor in Germany. Starting with this compound suberone, now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 steps. 16 steps from suberone to tropine. So he was able to devise the synthesis and carry it out. Now, the great difficulty of doing something like this can be seen if you simply look at the number of steps. Now, even in your plus two, you know that if you take a, suppose the textbook question, which you will get tomorrow in your exam, is from aniline, how do you make para-nitroaniline? Everybody knows that if you take aniline and put nitrating mixture in it, it will oxidize and whole thing will become a black mess. So you will say, take aniline, put acetic anhydride, make acetanilide to protect. Take acetanilide and nitrate it, you will get para-nitroacetanilide, which you can hydrolyze, and then you will get your para-nitroaniline. So you do two, three steps like that, you can imagine. A chemist can imagine that starting with aniline, how I get para-nitroaniline. But imagine doing it for 16 steps. Nobody, no human being can project a synthesis so deeply. And that is why this particular synthesis is really, really great. Now, the synthesis is great, but the great tragedy of Willstetter's life, I will put in the next slide. And the synthesis itself is so nice that I felt like putting it second time. Just to think that, can any human being think of so many steps like this if he just started with tropinone? Seems to me impossible. Now, Willstetter, as I said, he was a big professor in Munich and he got Nobel Prize in 1920. And then at the height of his fame in 1924, see, Willstetter, the tragic part of it is that he was a Jewish person. And the trouble with in Germany with Jews started actually even in the 19th century. But by 1924, suddenly one day, Willstetter, at the height of his power, I mean, imagine getting Nobel Prize and with a huge group of students, suddenly one day in 1924, he said, I'm going to give up my job and I'm going to go and sit at home because I don't like what is happening in Germany with Jewish people. I have a feeling that some bad things are going to happen. And you can see really this picture over here is in 1937. When the Nazis went and started actually destroying all the shops and all belonging to the Jews. And then a few years later, they started massacring all the Jews. Finally, 6 million of them they killed. So we know about the Holocaust. And I think Willstetter was guided by this. You know, I consider the teaching and study of the historical development as indispensable. Our textbooks fail in this respect. I think this can be said even today. We are not worrying enough about history. And when you don't worry enough about history, you know, you get into all kinds of problems. Now, something told Willstetter that things are not okay. Things are not okay. And then he said that, and then just think what happened afterwards to him. And then by 1939, he actually left Germany. He went, because then if he had stayed there, he would have been killed by the Nazis. He went to Switzerland. And over there, he died after 3 years. I always think a little bit that, you know, this Willstetter had this great foresight. In 1924, when he left the job at the height of his power, the Nazis were nowhere there. Hitler was actually being tried and being put into jail at that time. So at a time when nobody could have predicted that something like this happened, Willstetter could predict. And I think the answer actually comes in this synthesis. Anybody who can predict after 16 steps, the structure and then to do it in the lab. He is very good at predicting things. So like the way, same way in which he predicted this tropine, this tropinone, from tropinone he could give tropine. The same kind of skill in prediction he was able to use for his daily life. And then he knew what is going to happen. So it is very, very sad story. But I think once again, the power of predicting is something that cannot be underestimated in science. I still have about 20 minutes. Now, we'll go quickly through the next person. And he's Robert Robinson from England. Now look at, this is the molecule, same molecule again, a tropine. And look how Robinson did it. You know, he did the same synthesis in 1918, but he did it in an entirely different way from Willstetter. Willstetter started with tropinone and 16 steps. He did it elaborately. Now this man, Robinson, he took these three simple compounds. This is succinic dialdehyde. And then this is methylamine. And then this is acetone. Okay. And so literally he was able to carve out the molecule of a tropine by just putting the three components together. And this removes the elements of water through some simple condensation reactions, and then cut, the whole molecule falls together. So you can see what Robinson did was actually he took this structure and then he worked backwards. He said, what molecule will be required to give this structure? So now you see which structure is actually, which way is actually better. And when I think of Willstetter and Robinson, you know, I always think of this picture. I think all of you know what I'm talking about. This is a story which we are all told as children. So when the parents are sitting and having a good time with their children over here, they ask the children also, which of you loves us more? And then the younger son gets into the peacock and goes around the whole world. And the younger son does nothing. The elder son does nothing and he just waits. And when the younger brother is coming back, he just goes around the parents once. And then says, no, I have gone around the whole world. Why do you have to go like that physically? So if you take that Willstetter synthesis, it's a bit like Kartikeya over here going around the world. Robinson synthesis of tropine is like Ganesha. So sometimes the obvious solution is not the best solution. Willstetter gave you the obvious solution. Robinson gave you the unconventional solution. So I want you to also remember this, that it is sometimes in science it's very difficult. What is obvious may not be the best. Now I come now quickly to two people in the area of crystallography who did, I think they, I'm giving each of their stories for a different reason. This is Max von Laue. And he's the first person who observed diffraction in a crystal. And here is the very famous photograph, which probably says one of the famous photographs of science. It's written in German, the first X-ray diffraction picture of a crystal. So he found out that crystals can diffract and they will diffract X-rays. And he said that this is the diffraction picture. Now, why do I show this? I mean, the result is great, but I show this because you will not know the story of Laue unless you know the story of this guy over here. You know, this handsome man called Sommerfeld, who was Laue's, you know, PhD supervisor. Laue was a postdoc in Munich when he did this famous experiment of X-ray diffraction. The Sommerfeld fellow was a very, very interesting character. He, in his lab, worked people who got, finally five people in his lab got Nobel Prizes. And yet this gentleman was nominated for Nobel Prize 80 times and never got it. He holds the record of the number of nominations for a Nobel Prize. Now he was a very, very interesting character. He came from a military family and he would spend his off time in doing sword fighting and all that. And across his face, I believe there was a big scar which he got in fighting. So Laue, as a postdoc, has told Sommerfeld, he said, I've got this idea. And Sommerfeld said, no, it's a stupid idea, don't do it. So Laue was very scared. So he didn't do the experiment, but he was also not so scared. So one day when Sommerfeld went away for the weekend, quietly without telling anybody, he did the experiment, showed the result. And when Sommerfeld comes back on Monday, he says, see, this is the result that I got. So greatness of Sommerfeld here is that he saw this result and he said, this is fantastic. And he actually said, this will give you a Nobel Prize. So this was in 1912. He got the Nobel Prize in already by 1914. He got it in 2 years' time. Whereas Sommerfeld, with his all his brilliant career, never got Nobel Prize at all. Now, why is my picture over here? This, my own connection with Laue is that I was in 2014 in a small place in Germany, which is now Poland. where Lavey went to school. So in 100 year of this Nobel Prize of Lavey, the small celebration was done in his school. And because they had to commemorate this great man, and they actually showed us some of his report cards from his school over there, and it's written over there that he's quite a clever fellow, but he is not applying himself, and probably unless he does something properly, we don't see any bright career for him, or something like that they have written. So which means that those people who are coming first in the class in school and all that, they are necessarily not, they may not end up very successful also. So the fellow who was there, probably he's too clever for what they're teaching in that class, something like that. And so I was greatly privileged to be asked to come and inaugurate that plaque over there. It's a small place called Poznan in Poland now it is. And it was in those days, in Lavey's time, it was in Germany. So once again, you know, the example shows that you can, sometimes you can defy your own professor. Professor need not always be right. Student can be right and professor can be wrong. The great professor will know when the student is right and he's wrong, and he will admit it also. So it shows the greatness of Sommerfeld as well. Second person whom I want to show in the connection of X-ray is, of course, this very famous lady, Rosalind Franklin. And I think all of you know the photograph on the left-hand side. This is the photograph that she took of the DNA fiber, and which ultimately led to the cracking of the result of DNA by Crick, Watson, and Wilkins. And everybody knows her story, that the photograph was taken from her lab under not completely legal pretext. So there was some element of non-legality, I don't want to call it illegality, but some element of non-legality in how the photograph was taken from her lab and shown to Crick and Watson. So she has always remained a very charming character in science. And because she got cancer and died at the young age of 38, which was an occupational hazard for people who dealt with X-rays in those days, because it was quite unsafe. X-ray equipment was not safe. And so she got cancer at a very young age, and she died before Crick and Watson and Wilkins got the Nobel Prize. Actually, she is probably today, she is probably more famous than Crick and Watson, even though they got the structure of DNA. Just this year, UK has brought out a coin of 50p celebrating Rosalind Franklin. And this is a beautiful coin, which is actually, if you hold it at a certain angle, you will see the diffraction pattern. So it's a really, really nice coin. And no coin was made for Crick or Watson or Wilkins. So those who got the Nobel Prize did not get the coin. But the lady who did the coin, who did the photograph, got the coin. She never got a Nobel Prize, but got the coin. So this also shows, I mean, if you go back, it's also about dreaming, you know. Look at this cartoon here. It goes back to Kekule. I have just had a dream about a snake holding its own tail. It's given me a great idea about the structure of the benzene molecule, Kekule is telling his wife. Then he says, then another snake appeared, and the two of them coiled into an interesting double helix. So there are two different kinds of snakes here. Everybody is dreaming. So here is Rosalind Franklin with her family. She came from a very rich family in UK, also Jewish. And this is her result and all which she has given. It's a very, very interesting example of, how somebody... work will always be remembered. You may not get a Nobel Prize, but your work will be more famous than the person who got the Nobel Prize for that same work. So, I mean, this tells you that science is indeed interesting. What makes a scientist remembered is very, very strange and very elusive. Now, I have finished 8 people, and I cannot give a lecture like this without talking about people from India. So the last two people I'm going to mention are both from India. Here is Mahendralal Sarkar, a very famous doctor of Calcutta in the around 1860, 1870. And he was one of the first MBBS from India. And the story about Sarkar goes that He was just used to be very fond of medicine, so he was wandering around in the medical college. He was actually a student, first year student, and the professor inside was talking to the fifth year students, and he was asking a question. Nobody could answer. Then somebody from outside the room is shouting the answer correctly. So the teacher calls and says, "Who is this person who is giving the correct answer?" So Sarkar was brought in, and then he said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm a first year student or second year student." He said, "You know the answer to this, correct?" He said, "Sarkar said, yes, I know." So then he said, "My God, you are better than all these people who are done fifth year." So he was a very, very good doctor, very famous doctor and very rich doctor. And around 1870 or so, he became very much disillusioned with medicine. I think he was more disillusioned with the British in India at that time, because this was the height of the colonial rule. Then he took to homeopathy full time. And when he took to homeopathy, he got the criticism of all his admirers. Now think about that. You know, you become very famous, you become rich, you become this, you become that, and then you are willing to offend all your friends and all your admirers. And then you go into something like homeopathy. The greatness of Sarkar is he became a very great homeopath. So once you are good at something, you will be good at something else. And who were his patients when he was a homeopathic doctor? None other than Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, none other than Bankim Chandra Chatterjee. They used to consult with Sarkar, and they really believed in his homeopathic cure. So you can't discount a man like this. Now, what is the greatness of Sarkar? Sarkar, by the time, by about 1890 and so on, he was thoroughly disillusioned with the British in India. And he said that this whole thing like Calcutta University, Madras University, they are all just producing clerks. They are not producing, men of knowledge. And he says, we are not allowed to do scientific research. So he said, I am going to use my own money and I am going to build a place where people can do scientific research. And that is what he did, And he came up with this around 1900. And this is called the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science. And this is what Sarkar set up in those days. And he said that, you see, the British did not like it. This was the height of, this was Calcutta in those days. It was the second largest city in the British Empire. And this is the interior of the lab with the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science. He needed some extra money. So he went to the Maharaja of Visayanagaram. You see, in those days, Maharajas were giving money for all these things. Huge lab, Visayanagaram gave the money and he built it over here. Now the funny thing is, and see, the interesting thing about Indian Association for Cultivation of Science is that it still exists today. This is of course the modern campus in an area of Howrah of Calcutta called Jadavpur. And but in the old days it was in the North Calcutta, which is right up here. Today it is somewhere here now. Jadavpur is somewhere over here. And it was over there in those days. This is the new campus, of course. The IACS still goes on, and it is one of the most famous scientific institutions in India today. But this is the old building. This is called the Visayanagaram Lab. And the thing about Sarkar is that he did all this, but there was nobody working in the lab. Interesting. He put all the facilities. He said, people can come, they can do science. Nobody came. And when he died in 1906, he actually said that, my life is a failure. And he said that nobody will come and I've done all these things, but it's useless and that kind of thing. So he died a very disappointed man. But it almost looked like he is building this whole lab and everything for the sake of this last person, the last of my 10 people, who was in Calcutta in 1920 or so. And he was having a very highly paid job in the government, Sarkari Naukri he had. And he was very much interested in science, but I think he was pushed into this government job. Just like today, you people are all, maybe, I don't know, maybe they are pushing you, maybe they are not pushing you. Parents are telling you, you join IIT, then everything will be okay. Something like that. If you join IIT, then afterwards you will go to IIM. If you join IIM, you get a lot of money. In those days, government job was considered very big. Raman was earning huge salary as government employee, roughly like say somebody earning 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs a month today. And then he was seeing this Indian Association for Cultivation of Science. Every day on his way to work, he will see this. He's very interested in science. So he wanted to know what's going on here. So one day he came and it was all closed. An old fellow came outside and opened the door, and then Raman said, "What is this Indian Association for Cultivation of Science?" He says, "Can I come and do something over here?" So that guy started crying. And he said, "Look, we have been waiting for somebody like you." And so what Raman started doing in that lab is that every evening, every morning before his job and every evening after his job, he will stop there for a few hours and do scientific experiments. Now, after a few years, this science was getting too much, you know, mesmerizing for him. So he gave up his job. Now imagine, suppose you have a job today giving 2 lakhs per month, and then you give up the job completely and then just go and you are earning some 20,000 just to go to do some play to some place where somebody is saying you can do whatever you like. I don't think your parents will like it very much. They'll say, "What are you doing? Are you crazy or what?" You see, Raman was a bit crazy, but he knew exactly what he was doing. I mean, this is his family. This is Raman himself. He is from deep south in Tamil Nadu, and he came all the way, far away to Calcutta. And we all know, rest is history. By 28, he got this Raman effect, which is involves this radiation coming, and part of it is scattered, and the difference in wavelength between this and this gives you some property of the molecule which is in the solution over here, right over here. Okay, so that is the Raman effect, and for which he was quickly recognized. 28 he got this, just like Lavoie 2 years later he got the Nobel Prize. And you see what he says over here: "Treat me right and you will see the light. Treat me wrong and you will be gone." So you see, you need that kind of ego, and you need that kind of aggression, then you will have that kind of confidence to throw away a 2 lakh, 3 lakh job, because you know what you're doing. So you can see the story of all these 10 people I've told you today is a story of very, very strong individuals, people who believed in themselves, people who did not listen too much to other people, whether parents or friends or colleagues or this or that. They had a very strong idea about what they were doing. And it's only the power of science that allowed them to do all this. You know, today we are hearing lots of stories about science is like this, science is like that, you know, science is important. Finally, in the end, let me tell you, science is about dreaming, like what Kekule said. Science is about doing not obvious things, like what Robinson said. Science is about predicting, like what Willstetter said. Science is about certainty. I mean, I think among these people, Mendeleev stands out. He was so sure of his model that he said, "To hell with the data. I don't care about the data. My model is correct." So what gives a person that kind of confidence? Science has to be something which is very, very superior to be able to bring out all these qualities in these extraordinary people. And so today, I tell you people, you are all, you know, youngsters. India is changing. A lot of opportunities you will have, which we never had when we were youngsters. That's for sure. But make sure that you take the best of the opportunities available. And I would feel in the end, you know, when you look at the example of all these people, each and every one of you should try for a standard which is slightly higher than what you think you are capable of. Not very much higher. Like suppose if you have a, you know, problem with walking, you should not say, "I will climb Mount Everest." But at least you can say, "I want to walk from halfway across Bangalore. That I can do." you know, so you have to pitch it slightly higher than you are able to do. And I think all these people have pitched it higher. They always felt, you know, I can do something more. I can do something slightly better than what I'm doing. Only that gave them the confidence to go through and do all the wonderful things that they have done. So with this, I would like to say many, many thanks. I have rarely been to Rajasthan. You know, I've traveled all over India, but I've been to Rajasthan only 2 times. One exactly 50 years ago when I came to Udaipur, and one once about 4 or 5 years ago, and both the visits were kind of short. So I haven't seen much of your state, and it's part of the reason why I wanted to speak to all of you. But let me tell you that you are all youngsters. So I am not saying you should not take up engineering, or you should not take up science, or you should do this, or you should do that. But whatever you all do, try to see that your quality is always maintained. And please remember that unless you do something which is a little bold and little exciting, after some time, you will really feel that, you know, life itself has no meaning. And so don't do something just because hundreds of people around you are doing it. And just remember one last thing. All these chaps, even if you take Sarkar and Raman, think of a time 100 years from now. 100 years from now, imagine how many people who got B.Tech in IIT will be remembered even by name. I am able to remember Sarkar. I am able to remember Raman. I can remember a number of Indians who lived 100 years ago in science, and I can remember them today. How many IIT B.Techs today will be remembered 100 years from now? So that is the last question which I am giving to all of you before you run and do all these engineering exams. Just think about that, and then you worry about science and all is more about asking questions than giving you answers. I've given you a lot of questions today to think about. So now I want you to, well, you'll have to get back to your work and your preparation and all those things. So I guess now you've come out of the world of science back to the real world, but don't stop thinking. And with that, let me say that it's been a great pleasure for me to talk to all of you this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful talk. And on the YouTube live session, I am happy to share that more than 3,500 people have seen this lecture. And this is really, even we are also feeling blessed that you are agreed to deliver a talk. But on a YouTube live chat, there are so many questions which students have asked. And we cannot surely take all of the questions, but yes, we have very few. So it will be like, again, we'll be thankful that if you can give answers.
Definitely. I hope I will be able to answer the questions, you know, but you can just give a couple of the questions or representative questions, what they're asking.
Yeah. So one of the question, which
one of the things I cannot answer is how to pass IIT joint entrance exam.
Thank you, sir. So one of the question which was, it's kind of two, three people at least have asked about this, that what is your view about connection of spirituality and science? And you have talked about the scientific natural laws. So is there any spiritual connection, because these are natural laws? So this was the question.
See, answer is very simple. If you take all these 10 people I've talked about today, unless there is a spiritual connection in all those 10, they could not have done what they did. Impossible. Question is what you mean by spirit. And I will again give it with the example of Mendeleev. When somebody gets the idea of certainty which Mendeleev got, that he's so sure about his theory that he said to hell with the data. Unless you have read an enormous amount, you will not get that connection and that intuition. You can call it in a different language spirituality. Don't forget, Mendeleev wrote a best-selling textbook of organic chemistry when he was only 23 years old, and it became very popular all over Russia. So he knew so much about organic chemistry before he went into inorganic chemistry also. So he had read the enormous amount. And when you read that much, then at that point, I think Mendeleev was really seeing something spiritual there. Because he said this has to be correct, because it cannot be wrong. How can you say that something cannot be wrong unless you have had a spiritual experience, right? You know, it's impossible. So I would say that anybody who says that science is science, some spiritual is spiritual, that is not correct. I think there is a great deal of spirituality in science, especially higher level science. And like what the great Newton has said, he says, I only stand on the shoulders of giants. I think any serious scientist starts realizing how little he or she knows. And the moment you start realizing how little you know, then that is you are becoming now more spiritual. So I would answer this question in a very good way.
Okay. So another question is also a bit on a similar line actually. Dr. Girish Chandra Pathak have asked that what is required for the coexistence of science and religion, and will science, if yes, then will science and religion can coexist together?
Look, this answer here is very easy. I think in Sanatana Dharma, which is what I guess most of us are familiar with and we practice, in Sanatana Dharma, there is no real conflict between science and religion. Because the way in which our scriptures are laid out themselves are scientific, and Sanatana Dharma allows questioning, debate, and correction. Because we have got a beautiful system of Shruti and Smriti. So the Shrutis are forever and they are eternal truths, the laws, if you want to call it. The Smritis go on changing based on today's events. And 100 years ago till today, the Smritis will be different. So since we are not bound in Sanatana Dharma to one book, one prophet, one message, therefore in our context, I think we don't really have a conflict. And I think this is one of the great advantages in this particular country. And the fact is that we can actually synergize science with spirituality, religion. Religion is a very approximate word because it's an English word which doesn't have a translation in Indian languages. You know, part of the problem is, and whereas in the what are called religions of the book, namely Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, it is the conflicts start coming up, which is why Galileo got into all sorts of problems. And such problems, I think, are virtually impossible in our country. So I think we inhabitants of this country are very, very lucky that we are here, because we don't see big conflicts between what I would call, you know, religion. Religion is there is no conflict between Sanatana Dharma and science, okay? Then I am very confident of saying
that. Yes, sir. One of the questions from Ms. Harshita Malviya, she is the student, and she asked, why does scientific temperament is decreasing in India, and what we can do as a science student, and why there is no more C.V. Raman now?
Yeah, okay. See, thing is that we are losing because we are getting lost. We are getting lost in so many funny things that are going on around us. And we have lost, there are only two qualities, you know, what is her name? Malvika, is it?
Harshita Malviya.
Harshita, I want to tell Harshita only one particular thing. Sirf do qualities chahiye science ke liye. Ek hai courage, and dusra hai curiosity. And people can be more or less courageous and they can be more or less curious. But if you develop these ideas, then anybody can do science. You don't have to have anything else. This book knowledge and all. Just see, all these 10 scientists were very curious people. Raman became curious in the evening. He said, what is this building called Indian Association of Cultivation of Science? Lavoisier became curious. He said, what is this rubbish they are talking of negative weight? So he said, how can so many people be talking like this? He became curious and he started looking. suppose you are not curious and you said ha wo to apna kaam nahi hai and then you just gone or suppose you say ha aisa hi to hai india mein sab adjust karna padega then you know you are losing firstly you are losing your courage you are losing your curiosity also so these the problem I think today is that young people are getting very demoralized and I think they are not being allowed to think for themselves maybe this new education policy may push us little bit in the right direction but I think the real change has to come from inside and that is why I wanted to tell the story of these 10 people I don't think they never had problems you know Avogadro was Galileo was threatened with torture Lavoisier actually lost his head Winstetter threw away his job because otherwise he would be killed so it's not that these people were not under very very serious stress but they never gave up on the essential thing science is always catering to a very much higher idea and you must tell Achyuta really that the reason why we don't have Raman is that we have nobody today who is able to say if you treat me right you will see the light if you treat me wrong you will be gone somebody has that much confidence in their knowledge they'll say ha chalo ye sab bakwas hai the people don't have the courage to come and say all these things because once you know you're speaking the truth you know Saurabh, then you will not make any such problem you will not make a mistake because once you know you are speaking the truth then you don't care even to lose your head like Lavoisier you don't care to lose your job you don't care about anything at that point of time so I think we need a great deal of courage and we need much much curiosity we Indians are very uncurious lot we are not curious at all we are very happy to just see something and then keep quiet no I have to study for IIT are kya yaar kya milega IIT ke baad कुछ IIM मिलेगा IIM के बाद क्या मिलेगा बाद में यू नो यू हैव टू स्टार्ट क्वेश्चनिंग लिटिल बिट व्हाट डू आई रियली वांट टू डू आई हैव सीन सो मेनी पीपल हु गेट स्टक इन साइंस और इंजीनियरिंग हु वांट टू बी आर्टिस्ट हु वांट टू बी पेंटर्स हु वांट टू बी इकोनॉमिस्ट हु वांट टू बी सो मेनी थिंग्स फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई कैन टेल यू आई कन्फेस टूडे आई गॉट इन टू IIT एंड नेवर टुक अप बट आई टुक अप केमिस्ट्री इंस्टेड I never took up. I got high rank also. Chodo. My parents also never said anything. Okay, chalo, do whatever you like. Chemistry and history, I was thinking very seriously which I will take. It was not such an easy choice for me. And you know, see what Winstetter has said about history. If you don't look at history, you know, I think history, proper history should be put in all our science books. Unless you tell about phlogiston, how will you know the greatness of Lavoisier? You know, so I think you know we really need to develop. I'll tell all students and all, please do general reading. Read in all subjects, anything and everything. Just start reading. Okay.
Thank you, sir. And now I would like to request on Zoom all the faculty members that if they want to ask something to Professor Desi Raju. They can also unmute themselves and ask the question if they have some. Okay, if there is no question, then let me formally thank Professor Desi Raju. It was indeed pleasure, sir, and a blessing, I should say more, because it has reached to so many students, and even if few will be inspired by your talk, our ultimate aim will be fulfilled in this aspect. Thank you, because you have given the aspects of science which generally students never read in the books. Okay, there is chat. Okay, so thank you for this wonderful talk. I will not go into the much detail that what you have talked about, because ultimately it will remain forever on the YouTube, and it will not inspire now but inspire to many students who are going to watch this talk for years to come, I believe. And thank you. And once again, I would also like to thank Professor B.L. Ahuja. He is the Dean PG of our university, who has also joined with us today. And I would like to thank our head of the department, who always motivate us to do this kind of courageous thing, I should say. And Dr. Avinash Pawar, he's the associate professor in computer science, who have arranged all the things. And this program was under the co-association with the computer center. I would finally like to thank our honorable vice chancellor, Professor America Singh. Because of the busy schedule, he could not attend today, but his blessings was definitely there. I would also like to thank Professor Bhavani Singh from Kota University, who is also joined us today. And finally, I would like to thank our faculty members, really, that who has joined with this on Zoom. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And I hope that one day, definitely, we will ask you to come physically in Udaipur, because Udaipur, really, we want you to show Udaipur is indeed a beautiful city. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.